Time is filled with sweet transition. Not on earth can move, can stand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Changing hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Trust in Him who will not leave you. Whatsoever years may bring, if by earthly friends forsaken, still more closely to Him cling. Oh, hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging. Unchanging hand. Covet not this world's vain riches that so rapidly decay. Seek to gain the heavenly treasures. They will never pass away. Unchanging hand. Oh, hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hope on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Now when your journey is completed, if to God you have been true, fair and bright the home in glory, your enraptured soul will view. Oh, hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand.
he started on his journey, the holy angels cried. As he turned to face his father, this they heard him say, mankind owes a debt below that only I can pay. But I'll be back. Yes, I'll be back. I'll be gone for a little while. One day I'm coming back. I'll be back. On his way to Jerusalem, Jesus told his men, you'll see the Son betrayed there. There I'll be condemned. You'll see them mock me and curse me. You'll see me crucified. You'll see me suffer in agony. There you'll see me die. But I'll be back.
I'll be back.
Just a few short days, and I'll be back. It's one day on a hillside, as Jesus rose up in the clouds, the words he spoke came flooding back to some men in the crowd. He said, I go to prepare a place, but I'll come back again. Gonna take my people to a land where joy shall never end. Yes, I'll be back. I'll be back. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yes, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
I speak the name of Jesus over you. In your hurting, in your sorrow, I will ask my God to move. I speak the name, 'cause it's all that I can do. In desperation, I'll seek heaven and pray this for you. I pray for your healing, the circumstances would change. In Jesus' name,
She did an awesome job. I think she was getting into it. Real good job. We're just thankful for the talent we have here, don't we? That was a real good job, sis. He did real good. All right, we're going to go ahead and have the Brown Girls and Bo. Go ahead and come on up. Yeah, no pressure at all. Really good. Glad to hear them sing again, ain't we?
Some just see someone down on their knees, talking to the air, words lost on a breeze. Some just see teardrops fall into the floor, just a waste of time, not anything more. But it's a through the wind and the rain. Who kept you safe at the enemy's gate? Who was your shield on the firing line? Who gave you victory? Who turned the tide?
If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when the world rose against us, when the tide rose high, when the battle was lost and we drowned in the dark, we would be in despair. If it
friends had gone, who stood by your side, never left you alone, who healed your body, who spoke to your storm, who made a way out of a dead end road?
If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when the world rose against us, when the tide rose high, when the battle was lost and we drowned in the dark, we would be in despair. If it had not been the Lord, if it had not been for mercy, if it had not been for grace, if it had not been for the one who took our place, if it had not been for power, if it had not been for love, if it had not been for Jesus and his precious blood, if it had not been for mercy, if it had not been for grace, if it had not been for the one who took our place, if it had not been for power, if it had not been for love, if it had not been for Jesus
and his precious blood,
if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when the world rose against us, when the tide rose high, when the battle was lost and we drowned in the dark, we would be in despair. If it had not been the Lord, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when the world rose against us, when the tide rose high, when the battle was lost and we drowned in the dark, we would be in despair.
Appreciate this singing, don't we? Well, we have somebody been requesting for Shelly to sing this song, and we're going to go ahead and have her come up. And we haven't heard her in a while, but we do appreciate her singing, don't we? She always does a real good job. Let's get behind her as she sings.
Fail me all my days. I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. You were close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as the goodness of God.
Spirit showing up once again, don't we? You know, we just can't describe. It's just hard to explain the goodness of God, but all you can do is just raise your hands and say, Lord, thank you for everything you did for me. Woo! I love him tonight. You know, we have so much to be thankful for. We are so spoiled. Just can't help but thank him. He's way too good to me. He's way too good to my family. I just feel like I just don't give him enough, Freddie. I don't. You know, just like I said, we just keep hearing bad news after bad news, but here recently we've been hearing some good news, Doug. And I don't know, I mean, we should be on our feet just praising him and thanking him, Mike. He is, oh gosh, he is so worthy of our praise. I can just go on and on and on, but I don't want to do that to you. I'm getting ready to turn the preacher loose, but ain't he good to us? Just give him praise tonight. Let's go ahead and get behind Tom as a preacher. Thank you, Lord.
I was on some teams. We never won a whole lot, Roger, but I'm on the team right now that's going to win. Thank God. We're on the winning team tonight. Thankful for that. Hadn't it been a wonderful place to be tonight? Just I've enjoyed all the songs, enjoyed the Holy Spirit that's been here tonight. And It's no big running, jumping, shouting service, but the Holy Spirit is here in a real sweet way tonight, and he's came just for us. We appreciate him being here. Appreciate my old friend Roger Ronmus being here tonight. I went to school with him many, many years ago. He was just a couple years ahead of me, maybe a few years ahead of me. We won't rub that in tonight, but we appreciate Roger and his family. His dad, George, was the guy who trained me how to cruise timber, taught me how to go measure trees and all that, and how to, we used a little prism. It's a long story. I won't get into all that, but he's the one that taught me that stuff, and I've used it all my life. So we thank God for that tonight, but meant a lot to me through all the years. Good people, good family. If you want to turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 2 tonight. Now this is, I was looking in some of my stuff. I make marks in my Bible, make notes, different things. And I preached from this in 2013. All you remember that probably, don't you? 2013 when I preached this from this scripture. But I doubt it made that much impression on anybody. But we want to go to Nehemiah chapter 2 and verse 17. And I told Ted I'd only preach a couple of hours because the Bengals was playing tonight. So I'll try to get you home. But I want to read this scripture. It said, "Then said I unto them, ye see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me, also the king's words that he had spoken unto me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. Jerusalem lieth in waste, and the wall is broken down, the gates burned with fire." That sounds pretty sad, doesn't it? And his heart was broken when he seen what the homeland that he came from looked like. And this meant a little more to me as I was reading this today, because my homeland where I grew up burned to the ground this week. And it's a different experience when you see the place where you spent all those years of your life. And that was home to me, and it's gone now. Of course, Steve and Jack have been living there, but it's always been our home place, and it's just a different feeling. But I can understand his heart being broken when he came back to Jerusalem and seeing the kind of shape that his country and his homeland was in. Now, you don't need me to tell you tonight what kind of shape that America is in. It's not the America that I grew up in several years ago, but there's been a lot of things have changed. We've allowed our walls to be broken down, and we've opened up the floodgates and allowed sin to reign in our country today. And today was baby day, and I thought as we were honoring the babies that were born in 2022 this morning in that service, Congress passed a bill to stop partial birth abortions and late term abortions. And when that was done, Nancy Pelosi said it was an attack on women's rights. And the latest bill just passed allows same-sex marriages and has opened up the floodgates really to some things that God called an abomination in his word. And I know that our political system is definitely broken right now because party lines have become more important. Listen to me, this party and partisan thing has become much more important than doing what is right for America. And I don't care which side of the fence you're on tonight. We better wake up in America and realize we are all Americans. It's not about whether you're a Democrat or a Republican tonight, but we're Americans. But bigger than that, we have a holy God that we have to answer to. We live in a country, I believe the best country still on the face of the earth, who was founded upon the right principles, upon Christian principles, upon the freedom of religion, the freedom of worship, but that was the freedom to worship the true and living God. So we've allowed over the years that freedom of worship just to bring in about everything. And now whatever you want to worship, you can. We can't say anything about it. Whatever you want to identify, we're supposed to accept that today. And I said this one time from a pulpit, and I wasn't saying it to be funny, But I can identify as a chicken, but I'll never lay an egg. I'll guarantee you that. And you can identify as a lot of things, but whatever God created you tonight is exactly what you are. And this, as far as I'm concerned, okay? And I believe as far as the Word of God's concerned. So there's, these people are heathens, okay? And we can expect that, those kind of actions from people who don't know God. But the church has pretty much lost its effect on the world today. And you know why that is? That we've lost our effect? One thing, a lot of people in the church live just like the world. They don't live by any different standards than the world does. Only 28% of Christians, this was from a poll that was taken, 28% of Christians believe that the Bible stories are true. Now, how are you going to convince anybody to come and follow a God if you don't even believe that the Word of God that we read and that I live by is even true today? If only 28% believe that. So then what do we believe if we don't believe the Word of God? If I don't believe that this is the absolute truth right here, I might as well just pitch it in the garbage and go on and do it. If I'm going to live my life by what I feel, because that's where we're at in America. Well, I feel okay about it. There's people feel okay about committing murder. They don't have any conscience anymore. But I'm telling you this, that does not make it right. But we got to live, either this is our plumb line that I measure up my life to. If this isn't going to be the plumb line that I live by, then what am I going to live by? Whose standard am I going to live by? But I'm going to live by the Word of God tonight. So I got to get on with this because I told Ted I wouldn't keep him real late, so I got to keep moving. In chapter 2, in verse 19, Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem made fun of Nehemiah and the group that was out there rebuilding the wall. They began to make fun of him. And in verse 20, here's his answer to him. He said, listen to this. The God, I better read it out of my Bible because I can't read where I wrote it, okay? Verse 20 says this. He said, what is this thing that you do, or you rebel against me? In other words, they'd scorn and laugh. Then he answered and said unto them, the God of heaven, he will prosper us. Therefore, we his servants will arise and build, but ye have no portion, no right, nor memorial in Jerusalem. Now, that to me, if you want to go ahead and be critical and have a critical of the attitude of the ones that's trying to do the work of God, you go right ahead. You can be critical. You can make fun. You can find fault. Go ahead and do those things. But the Bible just right there said you'll have no portion or you'll have no right to the blessing. So I want to have the blessing, don't you? Thank God. So how can we repair the walls of the church? These walls, I told you, the church has lost its effectiveness in a lot of places. So how can we rebuild these walls? It starts with the leadership. In chapter 3 and verse 1, it said the high priest and his brethren, the other priests, were the ones, Caleb, that started working on the first section of the wall. So it's going to start with your leadership, rebuilding the churches. We're going to have to get some pastors that's got a backbone that will stand up and stand on the Word of God, stand up to some of this garbage that we're passing around right now, and a lot of churches are swallowing hook, line, and sinker. My brother's church had to vote, and they're leaving the conference that they've been in all these years because they're having two different types. They're going to be either a national, what they call it, or international, or whatever they called it, and then they have the other one that are traditionalists that are going to stand with what the Word of God says. So they had to make a choice, and they are. So they have to buy their building. It put them in a tough spot. But I'm glad they're standing, I believe, for what's right. So I'm thankful for that. God will take care of them. But the high priest and his brother and the priest built the first section. I love what's going on here at Beach Fork right now. The number one thing the enemy tries to use against your leadership is discouragement. I mean, you know, Doug and Caleb and myself, we talk once in a while about things. And you get up here, you know, I spend my Saturdays, usually, you know, or a lot of my time getting ready for a message for Sunday. And then you come and you pray, you know, you worry, you pray, you stay up. A lot of times Saturday nights are sleepless for me because I know we have church on Sunday. And I'm not complaining about that part. I think that's what we ought to do. But then when you come and you pour your heart out to people, and not a soul ever darkens the altars, it's pretty discouraging sometimes. But we haven't been seeing that lately. I thank God for we seen two saved here this morning in that service. Isn't that wonderful what God's doing? There was 22 saved last year, I believe. Am I right? 22 people saved here last year. And we've already started a year off in a good way, seeing people saved. And we thank the Lord for that. But the number was back up this morning. That's encouraging to your pastors. When we come in here and we know we have a church base of about 350 to 360 people, we could have that every Sunday if people would just show up. But we usually run upper 180s or 90s or 200. We had 221, I think, or two this morning. We're 222, wasn't it? We're three. Okay, 223. We're thankful for that great number. People showed up today. I know people's been sick. I know all these things. But I also know that there's a lot of other places people go besides church on the Lord's Day. Amen? But there are some people here that are stepping up and they're praying. And they're believing. And they're doing the things that they're being preached to and being taught in Sunday school and what have you. And they've been doing these things. And I'm going to tell you something. The devil might try to discourage the leadership, but Caleb, look at that group of young people sitting there behind you. They're still coming. Thank God that they're still got a heart for God and still got a heart to come to His house. And they're still using the altar and they're growing in faith. I'm glad to see these young people and what they're doing. Many churches have dissension among the leaders. They can't get along. We don't have that here right now, I'm going to tell you. We don't have that here. I feel nothing but unity tonight among our leadership. I like what Freddie done the other night when Caleb, I believe, was preaching. He got up and got behind him, and I come up and got behind him too, because we're going to back our leaders up. We're going to back each other up. And don't leave no place for the enemy to get in. There isn't no jealousy here. Only fighting we do is trying to let the other guy preach, if we can get him to, you know. That's a hard part for us. But I want these guys right here to know I got your back. I got your back, and I want the enemy to know that. We're not going to give no place to the devil. The second thing is every family had a section of the wall to build. So we had the leaders building their section. Every family had a section of the wall to build. Now, I'm going to tell you something tonight. I preached a little bit about that this morning in the baby service. But you are responsible for your family. Now, I pray for all your families. I do. I pray for you. I pray for your family. But I'll guarantee you, I don't carry a burden for your children, Melinda, like you do. I don't carry a burden for Doug's children like him and Tab do. But my burden's for my family. No one else is going to carry the burden for them like you. When it's yours in need, you take it to heart. My kids were out doing things at one time that they shouldn't have been doing. And it was Burnett and I that laid awake at night praying for them during those times. Now, I'm going to tell you something, young people. The Bible talks about when you sow to the wind, you'll reap a whirlwind. I sowed to the wind at one time in my life. And you're going to have things. I don't believe you're going to, you know, do the reaping in the next life, because I'm saved. I expect to go to heaven. I don't think but I've reaped some things in this life because of the life that I live before I give my heart to Jesus. Save yourself a lot of heartache and a lot of trouble and stay away from those things. Sometimes to win our families, we got to let some things go. You say, well, they done me wrong. So what? What's that amount to? That's it. Let it go. You're right on the money, Fred. Drop it. Let it go. That's what we need to do. What is more important, being right or seeing the walls mended? Seeing the walls rebuilt? Which one's more important tonight? It will most likely be up to you if you see those walls mended. See, we can't control the other guy. No matter how hard you may try, you're not going to change someone else. But we need to pray, God, you change me. Help me to be the one to mend the walls back that have been broken down. And I see this all the time. Families that haven't spoken to each other in years, don't live your life like that. Let's mend those walls. Let's be the one that'll step up and say, hey, even if you were, you know, would you rather be right, like I said, or would you rather see them mended? That's what we got to do. Thank God. I'll move on because I'm getting some funny looks from some people about that. In Nehemiah chapter 3 and verse 20, the third thing, and I'm about to wrap it up, Ted. This is the third point. You know, as preachers, always got 3 points. The leadership of the Spirit. That's the most important thing in our lives. You know, I believe that when you're saved, the Bible says we begin to walk after the Spirit and not after the flesh. And I believe that God gives us His Holy Spirit to direct us in our life. That still small voice that you hear speak to you, I don't get by, Freddie, with nothing. That if I speak out of turn to somebody and I don't treat them just right or whatever, I give somebody a little smart lip at some time, and none of you holy people, I know you don't do that. But if I do that, Roger, I don't get by with it. The Holy Spirit speaks to me right then, and I know when I've done something that I shouldn't have done. He didn't leave me in the dark, but He speaks to me right then. And it's the most important thing you can have in your life is a leadership of His Holy Spirit to guide you each day through your life. We need Him more than anything. Listen to this little story here now. In Nehemiah chapter 3 and verse 20, it said, after him, Baruch, the son of Zabai, earnestly repaired the other piece. Listen to this. He earnestly repaired the other piece. Now, his section of wall joined the section of the priest, but there wasn't really nothing special about his section. It was just another section of the wall. Nothing really special about it, but it was special to him. Here's what it said. He said he earnestly repaired it. It was important to him, Fred, because it was his section. Every one of you tonight, God has placed a ministry in your life. He's placed a section of the wall for you to build, a section for you to repair, or whatever it may be tonight. You've all got a section of the wall to carry. I've got a section. And I'm telling you this, I want to earnestly work on my piece of the wall tonight. I don't want to leave my work undone. And I can't do your part for you, and you can't do my part for me, but we're responsible for our section. Let's get in there and do it earnestly tonight, will we? Just because you're not in leadership don't mean you shouldn't have some spiritual convictions tonight. Some principles that you can stand on. I'm going to tell you, you can read the Word of God. You can believe the Word of God. You can pray and believe in God's power to answer prayers tonight. You hear me? If I didn't believe, now it's not about my prayers. You know, I don't even listen to my messages because you know what I hear when I listen to any of these messages that I preach? It sound like a hell jack. I know who I am. I know exactly who I am and where I came from. And I don't pray no eloquent prayers, but I know who I'm talking to. And it's not about me. It's not about my prayer. It's not about any power that I have, but it's the power of the one that I'm praying to tonight that I know He hears my prayer, Everett, and He will answer our prayers. If we are earnest like this fella here was about his part of the wall, and we can do that tonight. We can vow as Daniel and the three Hebrew boys did. You know, they said they wasn't going to eat of the king's meat. They didn't bow to his idols. They didn't do any of those things, but God took care of them, boys. They had some convictions that they stood on. They had some things that they believed in, and they stood on them, and God delivered them every time. You know all them stories. I don't need to go back over all that. But we got tonight, you know what? Them boys vowed that they weren't going to accept, and they wasn't going to participate in the sin that was going on around them. There's a lot of things and a lot of places I avoid. Maybe not because it would necessarily be sin to me to go there or whatever, but I don't have to partake. But if that's all going on around me, I really ain't got no business there. Even if I'm not partaking of what they're doing, I'm still rubbing shoulders in there with them on it, you know. I realize there's some things we can't control, that we have to be around. Some of you have to work among sinners. I work among sinners. And it's not always what we like, but you know what you can do? You can live the life before them. You know, we can dare to be different. We can earnestly serve the Lord and find our place tonight in the wall. Earnestly build our piece of the wall. Live a life that will be an example to the people around about us. You can make them hungry for what you have. I remember talking with a girl up at Lowe's, and somehow the conversation came up, and I told her that I went to Beach Fork. I don't even think that I told her I was the pastor there or here, but I just talked to her and said I went to Beach Fork. And you know what she told me? She said, if I ever get saved, that's where I'm going to go to church. You got a reputation here, whether you realize it or not. And there's been somebody from Beach Fork somewhere down the line that has been a witness to this girl. And she knows there's something different about those people that she dealt with from there. I can tell you this. We went somewhere not too long ago to eat. And the little girl messed up everything. She did. And she apologized. And we had to wait a while. And I told her, I said, I'm in no hurry. For one time in my life, I wasn't in a hurry. I didn't have anywhere to be. I said, don't worry about it. She just kept apologizing and wanted to come, and they were going to give us something off our bill or something for it. And I said, yeah, give us whatever it was. I said, look, I run a little place, eating place, and I said, we mess up all the time. You know, we're not perfect. We're going to mess up orders every once in a while. And I said, I know what it's like. And I said, don't worry about it. See, you can do that, or you could be the other guy and have a fit and tell them you want your meal free and all that stuff. And if you're one of them, Lord help you. Hope you don't ever need any mercy anywhere down the line. I want to put something in my mercy bank. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. That means if you don't put nothing in, don't expect to get much back. But I need mercy all the time, don't you? I need God's mercy, and I want to lay up something in His mercy bank so that when I need it, I'll have it. Thank God. Every one of us tonight has got our section of the wall to build. I can't do your work. You can't do mine. But I hope that we can purpose in our hearts together tonight. I knew kind of who I'd have as far as this was my faithful Sunday night crowd. We don't have 220 here tonight. But I'm thankful that you're here. And I believe that you want a purpose in your heart this year that we're going to do our part. We're going to repair our part of the wall. Whatever it is that's broken in our area, let's work to fix it tonight. Will you help me do that? Will you help me tonight do that? Thank God. I appreciate you. Let's stand to our feet tonight. I'm not going to sing Just As I Am, but I do want to offer you an opportunity to pray tonight. I don't know what some of you may be carrying tonight when you came in here, what burden you may be carrying, what load you may be carrying. Maybe you don't know Jesus as your Savior tonight. You'll never find a better opportunity than right now. As we bow our heads just for a few moments, let's bow our heads just for a moment. Is there anyone here tonight would love to step out, come up to this altar, and let us pray with you? I've said it many times, no virtue in this altar, but boy, it's sure a good place to meet God. And when you got some God's people around you, nothing else, we can help pray the devil away so you can talk to God tonight. Would you want to come out and pray? Anyone at all feel like stepping out tonight? Amen. Would anyone want to raise your hand tonight and say, you know, I didn't feel like praying up here, but I would like for the church to remember me this week? may be facing something that you could use the help of the church tonight. Anyone at all? There's one. Anyone else? Anyone else? I don't know what you're facing. You may not know what you're facing. We don't, but we'd like a church to pray. We thank God for that hand that was raised. Church, don't fail to pray for them this week. Still keep Steve and Jack in your prayers. They did want to thank the church. They went to get her clothes, and she couldn't find anything. She went to two or three places, finally did go and find some, and then he said they went to eat, and people were there that they knew, and he said we couldn't get away from them and held us up late, so he didn't make it back tonight. But he said, I hate it that I ain't going to be back for church, but I let them know, he said, how much he was just, I'm telling you, they were overwhelmed with your offering that you gave this morning, and I can't tell you how much I appreciate you. Even more bringing money in tonight for me to give to him. And we appreciate you all. We love you. Come back Wednesday night, 7:30. Tyler Breach is going to be.